more mechanisms. I mentioned mycotoxins. Those, anybody ever watch Doug Kaufman? He's got a TV show that talks about fungus. He's really on the leading edge of things that are caused by yeast. And he's done a big study on mycotoxins. Those are the poisons that are on grains and so on. And they have a very bad effect on the body. Good bacteria can degrade those. And a lot of the other things in our food that aren't good for us, they can help digest the food, make it so we don't react to it as much. And that one, vitamin A, you'll hear it on the news all the time like it's a fact. Carrots have vitamin A.
No.
They don't. They have beta carotene. The body converts vitamin A out of beta carotene, but only if all systems are go. There are a lot of those things that theoretically we can do unless we're deficient in a vitamin or under too much stress and so on. But most of that work is done by bacteria. So you might be deficient in vitamin A eating carrots all day long. That's another, the oxygen uptake, that's another reason you would have more energy if your bacteria are good. And they send signals to cancer cells because cancer cells, they lost their path somewhere along the line. They forgot that they're supposed to die. The good bacteria can help them remember that. So I mentioned these bacteria make things. I coined this term. I actually mentioned it in my first book because I couldn't find any word in use that meant all of the stuff that the bacteria make, plus their cell walls and their DNA. Even after they die, if they're no longer active, they still send messages. And so I coined the term postbiotic, and again in this book, now I'm starting to see it in some of the studies. I will never be acknowledged for having done that. But anyway, somebody had to do it. And that's really where it is. That is the reason that you want to take probiotics, is so that they will get busy and make this stuff for you. Because if you take one that's not active and you're not eating fermented foods and so on, they will eventually get there if they find a food source and they reproduce and so on. They will begin making these. If you want really fast results, you get one that already has postbiotics in it, whether it's fermented foods or a supplement. This is some of the just categories of things that they are known to make. And I mentioned this earlier, that the microbes go after the bad guys. When you take a broad-spectrum antibiotic drug, it is like a flamethrower. It just kills everything. Doesn't take names, say, oh, you're a good guy, you're a bad guy. Our bacteria do that. They don't want to kill other lactic acid bacteria because they work in teams. So they have developed the ability to be very selective and go after pathogens, which makes them very powerful. I mentioned that kind of, they make antioxidants, enzymes. They're thinking now that there may be hundreds of thousands of these different things the bacteria make. So the research will go on a long, long time because there's lots to look for now. They make neurotransmitters. This is what's firing up the psychiatric journals, is when they're finding, for example, melatonin, which you may know, helps with jet lag, particularly in sleep to some extent. 400% more is made in the gut than in the pineal gland, where they thought that was the main source. Serotonin and all of these other neurotransmitters are made there.
What are metabolites?
Metabolites are, you take something and it's, our metabolism turns it into something else. So metabolite is what happens after metabolism. We tend to think of metabolism just in terms of burning calories, but it really means you take one thing, usually an enzyme has an action on it, and now you have something else. So that's what happens with the bacteria. They might take your hamburger and make 1,000 things out of it. All of those things are metabolized from them. Good question. Yeah, I sometimes, you'd be surprised, sometimes I give these talks to professionals. They're thinking the same question, but they're not going to ask. Nitric oxide is very well known to help keep blood pressure low and give energy, actually made by the bacteria. Among the vitamins that these bacteria make, vitamin K2, I like to give a little extra shout out to, because it's the vitamin that keeps the calcium from building up in your arteries, sends it to the bones where it belongs. Vitamin D is starting to get some attention. Brand new study showing you're much more likely to get in trouble if you take calcium without vitamin D, but it really should be calcium with vitamin D and vitamin K2 because they work together. Vitamin D gets it into the body, K2 shows it where to go. A lot of these things, like short-chain fatty acids or something, so what? Well, those feed the lining of the intestinal tract, help give it energy so that it moves along and does what it's supposed to do, and has probably a lot of other functions as well. They're still sorting that out. That's one of those things nobody was too excited about, but now they are. And I don't want to talk about a product in particular. Reason I have all these is all of these bacteria, the reason we have maybe as many as 5,000 subtypes of bacteria is they tend to have different specialties. We need the variety so that we get all these jobs done. Every once in a while I'll be driving along and I'll see somebody driving a backhoe and I think, thank goodness, not everybody wants to be a rocket scientist. What would happen to us if somebody didn't want to run a restaurant or do all these things? We need all of these different jobs, so we need to worry about diversity of our gut contents. Now, I think the probiotic supplement that I saw that had the most different types, and I think more is better as long as all of the strains that are in a probiotic supplement have been well researched, and some of them probably not so much, haven't really had a lot of research. Just to say you've got 40 is not so important. When we're looking at that many different types we have in our gut, so we ought to be thinking more about what can we do to support the whole complex. In the studies, I did see that by and large, whenever they did a single strain versus a multi-strain, they got better results with a multi-strain, because you're probably encouraging, you take one, it encourages some others in the gut. If you take more, you're encouraging a wider variety. I really worry about, there are a couple out there that are just massive, just one strain in a powder and you take a lot of it, you will get a reaction. You probably will get a BM, you know, the BM, the mother of all BMs. But that doesn't mean it's doing anything to support the diversity. There is one place, and I talk about this in the book, fecal transplant is the best way to cure an incurable C. diff. You'll hear that hospitals, people get that after antibiotics, especially in the hospital, and it's a diarrhea that can't stop and people die from it. If they transplant the entire gut contents from a healthy person to that person, they can stop it. They also found a whole lot of other good things happened, and so there's interest now in having there is a place where you can have a stool specimen saved for you in case you're in trouble later, and it's called a poop bank. Then you're getting a supplement of all of yours. Aside from that, it's going to be kind of difficult. These great amounts, they're also working on a way to sterilize it and separate these and still have one that has, you know, 1,000 different kinds, and that'll be interesting. We just aren't there yet. If you give the body a massive amount, like a whole teaspoon of one of these powdered ones that's one or two strains, the other bacteria, I mean, it upsets the balance, and the other the immune system may well say, this is wrong, I don't like this, something's out of hand, and you may get something on the order of an autoimmune or some other negative reaction. We're still looking into that. If you feed the bacteria different foods, a wide variety of foods, you get more diversity in the strains. Many years ago, and in some other cultures today, they have 150 food substances in their diet, different kinds of foods, and all these different bacteria have different preferences. They like different things. Now, maybe about 15, if you don't count the chemicals, if you just look at the foods, go through the supermarket and say, well, if I got rid of wheat and soy and sugar and corn, dairy, you know, it's, you might have trouble coming up with 15. That's how we've gotten. You can go over in the produce department, oh, now it opens up a whole lot more. And you go into the seeds and the nuts, you find more. And these bacteria like different kinds of foods, and so that's what we need to feed them. This is the biggest, I think, myth. When you see marketing for probiotics, it's a numbers game. It's like, oh, I'll see your $5 billion, I'll raise you $5 billion. I'm at $10 billion. Oh, well, ours is $20 billion. Ours is, you know, $50 billion. I heard Dr. Oz one time say, oh, it has to have $25 billion. Nowhere in any of those 1,000 studies was there any reference to a magic number like $25 billion. That's, who knows where that came from. It's much more important they be the right strains and they be researched and they're what you need, and more important than all that is you feed the ones you already have, right? But there is a magic number.
What is CFU?
That's a good one. The last time I used this was with retailers, and they're used to throwing that term around. That's the colony forming units. Thank you for keeping me honest up here. I can't tell you how much I appreciate that. Because a lot of people will probably say, well, I guess I should know that, but I don't. that's if you, they are live bacteria supposedly at the time they are processed and put into the bottle. And all conditions being right, they survive the trip and, you know, get into you and so on, they could form a colony. So every bacteria is a colony forming unit.
Are you going to bring up soil-based probiotics, and then I guess these, because I know some are refrigerated and some aren't. I don't know.
Okay, let's just handle right now. It's out there. Soil-based bacteria. My preference is soil-based. There are zillions of bacteria in the soil. Some of them will kill you. Some of them are okay. They're one that I know of that has a track record of having been. And it's not one of the big commercial brands. It's actually a multi-level of network marketing that has been proven over time to be useful. I prefer the soil bacteria to be isolated from an animal that ate it and didn't die. So that's what I think about that, about soil-based refrigeration. That has to do less with anything other than processing. One that I like a lot and take personally is fermented at room temperature and comes in a paste of the food that it was eating, so it's stable. Some of the others, they have to be refrigerated because they've been freeze-dried and separated and they're a little bit fragile. And so I worry with those every time you open, even in Texas, when we didn't used to have a lot of humidity, we do now, you open the top, they're cold, humidity gets in there, I think it may degrade faster. Some of them have just been processed in a way that they claim are shelf stable. So doesn't necessarily have a lot to do with how effective they are at the end of the day. That's the magic number.
And
wow.
What is that number?
Yeah.
I think it's 28 quadrillion. I had to look it up because we know right now government numbers, are kind of in here somewhere. That number is if you take 100 bacteria, they double every half an hour. 24 hours, that's how many you get. That's why I think it's so important to make sure you got the right guy to begin with. Because if he's going to end up with that many of them, it would be a good thing. If it's something that we're not supposed to have, because it, somewhere along the line, his buddies and his competitive neighbors are going to cut that down if it's not something that's good for us, which is different than taking 28 quadrillion all at once. That's why there's a difference. So keeping the environment good so that our good bacteria can multiply to those kinds of numbers is good. You can do the math. That's the old trick about, would you rather have $10 today or a penny doubled every day for 30 days? Yep. I had to put it on an Excel spreadsheet and double check it two or three times because that's not a reasonable number, but that's what it came out. So, again, this is what I think is more important than getting a gazillion bacteria in your supplement to begin with, is make sure it's proven, make a good home for it, and don't kill. We'll get a little bit, I think, into, although I'm probably running short on time, is to not kill it off. There are an awful lot of things we do that kill them off. So, in a fermented food, you get these postbiotics. And again, you need a variety of fermented foods because they're each going to support certain strains. But as you have generation after generation after generation of bacteria, so I think it's really, you're getting the benefit of trillions, not billions. So you're going to get bombarded with all of these big numbers in marketing, but as long as you kind of get the basic concept that with a fermented food like the kombucha, that was not one generation of organisms. You open one up 3 days from now and it'll fizz. There's still activity going on there, meaning that they're reproducing, so you've got generation after generation continuing to do their work. There's one that's very good. This is one I particularly like. It's very good for immunity and pathogens and so on. But this is an example. This slide is covered in bacteria. This is what you get with an antibiotic. This is with a probiotic. You get much better clearance of the area. Another thing I picked up at Harvard was they studied how fast you could change the gut bacteria. They're looking at big blocks of, did this whole species, genus, did they go up or did they go down 24 hours? You change the diet, the dynamics are reflected that fast. So I hated to hear that because I like to be good all week and on Saturday night blow it and eat a bunch of crap I would ordinarily not eat. It's kind of, because that gives me a week to be in good shape before the radio show again. So now I'm thinking, well, there goes my cheat day. But another interesting prebiotic, and that's the prebiotic part up there, that's what comes before the bacteria, that's the food they eat. The postbiotics are what they've made. The pre is this. They knew that there were these oligosaccharides. It's kind of a complex sugar chain that were in breast milk. Mother nor baby can digest those. Only the bacteria. Nature put them in breast milk to feed the bacteria. So, as far as I know, they're not putting that in the baby formulas. You'll see this in a lot of products, FOS or inulin. They're put in there to feed the bacteria, and they're called prebiotics. What the studies show is it increases the numbers of the bacteria, but it doesn't help the diversity. Nothing like eating a variety of foods. They like fiber and mucilage from all of these kinds of things. They do eat meat. But the studies on that, they're prejudiced. They put one up at Harvard, and I just shook my head. They did a comparison of what happened to the gut bacteria on a plant-based diet, vegetarian diet, versus a meat diet. Well, later I looked up and I got the worksheets where you could see what they actually fed these folks. And this were human studies. They fed the vegetarians fresh vegetables and herbs, and it was all just very lovely. And then I looked at the meat side. It was all bacon and sausage. And they wanted that to prove that meat was bad for you, because everybody knows that those foods have all those additives and chemicals in them. That was like, and this is Harvard, so whatever. Just as an example, we get fooled again by marketing. Bacteria love these. That's unless they've been irradiated, so the bacteria won't love them anymore. Which is harder and harder to figure out when you go to the produce department. But that's got the real fibers, it's got the nutrients and the vitamins and all the rich assortment of nutrition that the bacteria need. However, strawberry flavor, that is what strawberry flavor looks like. From what I've learned, there are a lot of things in there that are just lethal to our good bacteria. So when you're eating, things are made with white flour, sugar, and chemicals. You're killing all the good guys and only supporting yeast. So, it's always good if you can get one where the finished product, not just the individual strains, have been studied together. You get a better idea. You get fast results. There's one chewable. They're a sponsor on our show, and I just have to say, they're a sponsor on the show because I love the product. I don't love the product because they're a sponsor on our show. If you get a little bit of heartburn, instead of those things that they, even Rolaids that they talk about, chew up two of those and it stops it now, probably because of the enzymes and who knows what all is in there, but you're doing some good along with it. You're not cutting off your stomach acid that your body needs for B12 and protein and zinc absorption and magnesium absorption and so on. Refrigeration, we already talked about that. The way they make the freeze-dried ones, they'll culture it like they would yogurt, like overnight, and then they separate out the food supply, they send it through a centrifuge, break up the colonies, freeze-dry it. That just makes them a little bit more fragile. It doesn't mean they don't still do good, because as I said, even the ones that don't survive and multiply, their cell walls and the DNA in their little bacterial carcasses are still useful. So I don't want to talk about an individual product. I think probiotics ought to be the foundation of a supplement program. I mean, now that you see all the things that they do, why do you want to throw down a bunch of other things when your gut doesn't know what to do with it, possibly? And this is an example. I read about this study, the pomegranate. They gave pomegranate, and I'm sure that the Palm Wonderful people spread this word around. They gave as to animals, the animals lived a lot longer, they had better flexibility and energy and so on, and they didn't lose their muscle over time. But that was only after bacteria worked on it. Well, if you didn't have the bacteria, you could drink all the pomegranate juice you want, and you would not get the benefit that those mice did. Because this is just to reiterate a point. When you're seeing advertising, remember all of these medical disciplines are looking at it, and we can't just judge a probiotic about whether or not you get to hear from it tomorrow in the bathroom. So a little bit about protecting our microbes. I should just say, anybody that writes a nonfiction book like this expecting it to be a moneymaker really needs to do a little more research. This is a mission kind of thing. I make 30 cents a book on these. So even though it's a national bestseller, it's still squat. But I'm paid when I get emails from people who say, I think you might have saved my life because I got off of that, I was having these problems, and now I don't have them anymore. That's my payment. But one thing, and the research is now starting to show it, oh, if we take these drugs, we mess up our gut bacteria. So all bets are off on a whole lot of things, and it's no wonder that they're showing kidney disease and heart attacks and cancer and things linked to the acid-blocking drugs.
So when you have friends that are on antibiotics, can they take probiotics at a different time of day, or they just need to wait till they're finished? I mean, this is when you can't get them off, so I'm just saying, can they still be on it and just take it at a different time of day?
Okay, the question is, there is a good logical reason to take an antibiotic. What do you do about the probiotics? Start them at the same time, but not the same time of day. You're exactly right, because the antibiotic, you don't want it killing off your good guys. Some people worry that because it says pro and the other's anti, they're going to fight each other. Well, it's not a fair battle. The antibiotics kill the probiotics. So actually, antibiotics work better if you're also getting probiotics, and eliminates a lot of the side effects, but allow a couple of hours between so that you're not doing them at the same time. And after you're finished, I've heard doctors say, have some yogurt this week, you're good. No, it takes 3 months to anywhere near approximate the gut microbe selection that you had before. So you want to keep taking it for a long time afterwards, and I would take a lot, because I've got a whole chapter in this book about what antibiotics do to you. Sometimes I'm going to have a problem a week from now, or I'm going to die today. Okay, let's have the antibiotic, but then try to offset the damage. But half of the antibiotics are given incorrectly. They're not needed. They're for a virus. They're for mysterious prevention and so on. The studies show, and the doctors admit that, but a lot of times it's the patients who come in and say, I want an antibiotic, because they don't understand the system. And in a 6-minute office visit, you can't explain, what we're taking more than an hour to do here. So antibiotics are by far, I think, the most lethal, but really almost all drugs have a bad effect. And we could go on and on. I was very discouraged to find out they spray antibiotics on vegetables. We know it's bad enough that if you don't buy organic or grass-fed, that it comes through in a lot of the dairy products and the meat products, but they for whatever reason, they spray them on vegetables sometimes, too. So with GMO, the best reason to not do GMOs is for your friendly bacteria, because the only reason they do GMO is so they can use Roundup on the crops, and they're showing that comes through in the food supply. They say, oh, well, it won't kill you, it's only a little bit. No, it's not toxic like you're going to die in the next month, but who knows what a little bit on your breakfast cereal every day for 10 years does? They don't do those studies, so I just think we need to stay away from that. And things that you wouldn't think, like ice cream and salad dressings that have emulsifiers in it, those are not good for the bacteria. Water purification, I should a minute on that. I'm going to ask you this time. You're asking me all the questions. Why do they put chlorine in water, in drinking water?
Probably to kill
the bacteria. Yeah, exactly. That's its sole purpose, kill bacteria. Mm-hmm. So if you're drinking tap water, you're giving your little guys a dose of something that's intended to kill them. And I don't know that I really looked at fluoride, but I'm pretty sure it's not something they need, at the very least.
Which is so, like when we shower, we're putting all that treated water on our large organ of our body.
The question is about water in the shower. We actually absorb more chlorine from shower water than we do from what we drink. That's why I use a shower filter.
Which one do you use?
I use Aquasana. May not be the best, but it's one that sends me a new filter every little while. And I'm just because I don't want to dry out my skin. I don't take a ton of showers anyway. I do the minimum and leave the water on as little as possible, and it saves water as well. But mostly, you know how relaxing a nice hot shower is if you don't have a shower filter? A lot of that is the chloroform that is made in the steam. So anyway, we have 100 trillion team members, and I would like to get a little respect for them, please. So thank you very much. That's the book. They've got some over there, but